strette, strette come butto, belle faste già sotto celle di Roma. Down each avenue, via street or strada, you can see them disappearing two by two on an evening in Roma. Do they take him for espresso? Yeah, I guess so. On each lover's arm.
Hey, Antioch family, here we are in Rome. Last night the team got in. And we had a great time going around the city of Rome, downtown. We saw the Colosseum, the Roman Forum, Paul's Prison, Parthenon, Trevi Fountain, and a few other things. And so we just had a great time. We've been eating cannolis every day the last 2 days. Great. Some pizza. And just can't wait to see the rest of you guys. Can't believe we have 175 people coming from Orlando, Florida. That's insane. So anyways, I wanted to give you guys a little bit of vision. What I've been sharing with the teams and the base team this morning from Acts 13. It says here that now there were at Antioch in the church that was there prophets and teachers, Barnabas and Simeon, who was called Niger, and Lucius of Cyrene, Manan, who had been brought up with Herod the Tetrarch, and Saul. While they were ministering to the Lord and fasting, the Holy Spirit said, "Set apart for me Barnabas and Saul for the work to which I have called them." And then they had fasted and prayed and laid their hands on them, and they sent them away. And then in verse 4 says they went down by the Holy Spirit, and they went and proclaimed the word of God in the synagogues of the Jews. And they also had John as their helper. And then if you go to Acts 9, if you remember a little bit about Paul's journey and him getting saved. It says here, sorry about that. Got a lot going on here. It says that, you know, he got saved radically, and they were afraid of him. They were afraid of Paul. And who was it that came to Paul's rescue? It was Barnabas. And then it says, because Barnabas took a hold of him and brought him to the church, and then they learned that he was the real deal, that he had gotten saved. God loves to save people like him, like that, that are sinners and murderers and thieves and the immoral, and he loves to save them for his own glory. It says here in verse 31, so the church throughout all of Judea and Galilee and Samaria enjoyed peace, being built up, going on in the fear of the Lord and in comfort of the Holy Spirit, it continued to increase. That's who we want to be, an apostolic and an apostolic people and a family. We're an apostolic family, and that's who we always have been and always will be as a church. Can't imagine being anybody else. And just seeing all these lovely faces here in Rome, just seeing that, man, God has just done the first step. He provided all the money, the 90,000, last 90,000 came in. That was amazing. We're all here, and now starts the work of training, of going out, learning the transit system. But people need vision. And as I've been praying and waiting on the Lord, I just came to Acts 9. Also, got Acts 13, and then also I looked at Acts 11 too as well, that it was Barnabas who was sent from Jerusalem to go to Antioch to see what was going on. Is it legitimate? Is it real? And then when Barnabas got there, he encouraged them. And it says here, he encouraged them with a resolute heart to remain true to the Lord. He was a man who encouraged the apostolic ministry. It's hard. I mean, you know, whether it's jet lag or whether it's just people rejecting you and whatever it might be, it's hard work, right? We all know that. And it says here that Barnabas realized he was limited. He needed Paul. So he went to go get Paul and bring him to Antioch. And it says then the church grew again. And he taught, it says the church grew considerably. And over and over, you see that in Acts 9, you see that in 11, and you see that in 13, that when Paul and Barnabas got together, when you have the apostle who's taking land, who's sharing the gospel, who's evangelistic. Those are the people we are. We've always have been. And then also coupled with family, with encouragement. I mean, Barnabas is the son of encouragement. And without Barnabas, there'd be no Paul. I ended up sharing a few stories from the time in London. Wish I could share so many more stories. I can't. I think they recorded the message from this morning. So maybe you could reach out to one of the administrators here, and they would help you out in getting the video or the audio for that. But just got to share a lot of inspiring stories from church history. And two things I want to land on is that all these great men and women of faith that were in the Reformation, during the times of the Reformation, a lot of them were in London, and we saw a lot of their spots where they did great work. But none of them went out to change the world. None of them were like, we're going to change the world today. We're going to be world changers. None of them did that. They were just faithful. They abided with the Lord. They went deep. They dug their roots deep into the soil of God's word, and Jesus brought up the fruit. And that's what he calls us to do in John 15. You can't do anything without him, without being connected to him. And so we want to be faithful here. We want to be faithful in evangelism. We want to see Johnny's church grow. Can you please pray for that his church would grow, that we would be a stronger church. As it says here, we would grow in peace. As it says here at the end of Acts 9, I'll read it again, because I think it's such a great reminder of who we want to be. It says, when Paul and Barnabas got together, this is what happens when people who want to take land, and you got the family who's encouraging each other to continue to go, don't give up. You got a church throughout all of Judea, Galilee, and Samaria, all over. They enjoyed peace. They were being built up. They were strengthened. They were going on in the fear of the Lord. They loved God. They wanted to obey him. And in the comfort of the Holy Spirit, they were comforted. They were encouraged. And they wanted, and God continued to increase that church. And so just so thankful for the people that just in faith said, hey, I want to go. I want to see God move. And I'm praying that this would be an incredible time. This would be one of our best mission trips yet, and that we would see God move powerfully as we as a church become more dependent on God in prayer and reliant on the Holy Spirit, that we'll have, of the men of old, they all had a ballast in their boat, a strong ballast in their boat, that when the opposition came, they were not capsized. They continued to go. They hoisted their sails. They had wind in their sails, and they allowed the Spirit of God to lead them and give them wisdom and boldness and courage to see God's kingdom come in such a dark world. And so we're living the same time. I mean, yeah, maybe it's gotten worse or whatever, but I mean, people aren't being burned at the stake right now, but it's just incredible that these guys, their lives are being threatened, yet they were faithful, and God brought the fruit, and we're reaping a lot of their work today. So love y'all, and I'll talk to you soon. Hey church, as we get ready to pray this morning, I felt like God put on my heart a few things. One, let's just pray for good health, because you know it says in 3 John that your health may prosper. It talks about, and you know, as I was in school, one of the things I remember a student was asking a question, saying, "Well, wait, doesn't that sound like prosperity gospel?" And you know, I remember one of the professors saying, well, it's actually not, when you think about it. To pray for good health is to pray that the gospel will be advanced, because as people are healthy and able and strong, they can go on and share the gospel and not stay in bed, not be sick. And so we have a couple of people that are sick with the flu bug. I know Judah's been throwing up, Henry's been throwing up, Jessica has been throwing up. So just be praying for our families. And I think, you know, there's a little element of a spiritual attack in there too as well. And so just be praying that our leaders would be healthy, that we'd be able to lead teams. It's really important that we get off to the right start. Yesterday, we shared vision about just being an apostolic family. And we want to see that happen. We want to see that God would strengthen our church here, that with the comfort of the Holy Spirit and just the boldness and the fear of the Lord as we go out boldly and share and be courageous. But also and see salvations, and that we would see many people saved here, that we would see Johnny's church grow. Also that we would be a family. We would be a people who encourage one another and love one another and look at each other in the eye and make sure that we're paying attention to one another and not just trying to blaze a trail and make a name for ourselves or, you know, and do it independently, but interdependently as we depend on God. So those are some of the things you guys could be praying for. I love y'all, and I'll see you soon.